It's time for another mailbag. Stuff keeps coming in, so I better open it. Let's start with this one down here. Electronic parts. Of course it is. What else do I ever order from China? Oh, multiple things. Okay. What have we got here? Ah, some test clip lead things. Cool. Looks like, okay. So you stick the wire in there. Let's see if I've got a piece of somewhat flexible wire. Oh, that's perfect. Just get my clippers here. Strip that back a little bit. Now then, how does this work? Looks like we solder them in there. Only not quite so splayed out. And then where's that little slot go? That's got to go that way. Okay, there's a notch on the back of that piece. And down there's a slot. So that's got to go in that way. Solder it on, which I'm not going to do right this moment. And then there. Nice. And what do we got here? 2, 4, 6, 8, 10 of them in 5 different colors. Cool. Okay. 10 pieces large round single hook clips test probe from Alice 110 1983 dollar 75 Canadian. What else have we got here? Ah, an RFID kit. So this comes with the little RFID board, a couple of sets of pin headers. Oh, nice. You can either have straights or bent ones. Cool. And one flat card and one key tag tape card. So what does it say? What's going on here? One thing I'm noticing with these new lights is everything's so glary. So what do we have on there? No, that's the right way up the first time. SDA, SCL, MOSI, MISO, MISO, IRQ, ground, reset, and 3 volts. Okay. This is a fairly standard type RFID thing, so it should work with the Arduinos just using out-of-the-box sketches. I'll tinker with that sometime in the near future. Cool. Also from Alice, the RFID RC522 card read antenna RF RFID reader IC prox card blah blah blah. $2.40 free shipping with everything we see here. So this thing says it's a 13.56 megahertz type card. Advanced modulation, demodulation, high speed. Not an awful lot of information there. What's down here further? The modules, 3.3 volt SPI interface. Okay, we sort of decided that anyway, looking at it. Operating current 13 to 26 milliamps. There we go. Ooh, tons of bubble wrap. Ah, there that is. I know I ordered this eons ago. This is a dummy load basically for power banks for load testing them. So hang on, there's a little power bank. Where's my. Okay, so plug that guy in. Can you see that? Okay. So that says, I wonder if you can read it if I zoom in. Not really. Oh, 4.90 milliamp hours. And this thing has a switch for either 1 amp draw or 2 amp draw. Basically just switches one or both resistors in. The big honking power resistor, wire wound power resistors. So if I plug that in the 1 amp mode, there's that. And this thing says 0.85 amps at 4.8 volts. Okay, if I drop it into 2 amp mode, it drags this guy down to 3.8 to 4 volts. Oh, come on, be visible. You have to ignore it for it. And 1.2, 1.3 amps. And the LED goes way dim, but if I go back up to 1 volt or 1 amp. So I always knew this was a crappy little power bank because it was a freebie that I got from a salesperson at work or something. But it does the job. And also in the same package from Alice, the USB load resistor power resistors, mobile power aging resistance module, 1 amp, 2 amps. Yeah, two big honking resistors, a switch, and an LED. That's about it. $1.26, free shipping. Everybody sells these things. Discharge resistors will become hot. The temperature at 80 to 85 Celsius. That's what happens when you're throwing all that wattage into a big honking resistor. All right, cool. Next thing, it says commercial sample printed. Canada Post stickers obliterating the lies that are on there. So we'll just have to see for ourselves what it is. Ah, it's, well, it's like a little MP3 player kind of kit sort of thing. Can I peel that open? There we go. Ooh, okay. Knobbly bit. Okay, so we have a front panel and we have a remote control and we have probably a power wire and probably a speaker wire. What are the connectors labeled on the back? Oh yes, there we go. Yeah, 5 volts and ground. On that one, that's the 2-pin. And out left, ground, out right, and antenna. So, where does that go? Okay, so the red one's the antenna. Okay. And it has a USB input, an auxiliary input, a TF, which is SD, actually. In English. Oh, there's where that little thing that went running away goes. That's just that. Let's zoom out just a hair. So we have volume plus and minus, scan and mode. I think I might just power this thing up and play with it for a second here. Excuse me. Okay. I've been away for a moment. I went and got a speaker. Hooked this guy up to 5 volts from my little power supply here. And on. It says hi. And now we have FM. 87.5 FM. What's it doing? Oh, it's scanning. Okay. And it's programming all the FMs that it finds, so that's pretty cool. Line input. FM. Okay, well, that's kind of neat that it was automatically doing that. I threw some YouTube Don't Sue Me music onto a USB stick, so let's see what happens when I plug that in. I wonder how you get into volume up and down. There we go. That's I guess I need an amplifier after it, but I am hearing my music out of the speaker. And it sounds pretty decent actually. So if I do that, skip to the next song. Okay, that's kind of neat. So there's FM mode again. Pull the USB out and I'll try SD card. Which way up does it want to go? Jams that way, so no. Which one? I guess we'll try it. There we go. I put the same music on both of them. Well, that's pretty slick. No. Look at this remote. Does it actually have a battery in it? It does have a battery. It's kind of jammed, but it does have a battery. Neato. Okay. So let's see what happens. That works. Cool. It's volume up. It looks like 50 is the maximum volume. And it goes down from there. Okay, that's neat. And mode. FM. Line input. Back to that. I'm just using the mode button on the remote here now. And the stop button. Okay. And the play button. And the play pause. Right. Well, that's neat. Power button. It says off and it's gone. Power getting again. Hi. And back to music. EQ button. EQ 91, 92, 93, 94, 1991, 92, 90. Oh, EQ. Sorry, not E9. Okay. That's a mode. Go back to FM. If I hold the antenna wire, sounds a lot better. But I'm not going to stay on that mode for very long. Well, that is pretty cool. Wonder what the eBay listing has to say about it. The MP3 player, Pro MP3 WMV decoder board. Oh, I didn't try WMV, which is fine because nobody uses that, do they? Hardly ever. Decoder board audio receive module, UDisc TF with remote control gift. Strange way to put it. From Shang and Changpin Shop. There it is. Free shipping from China. Does it say much about it? Oh, it does. Quantity one, materials, plastic and circuit board. Yeah, okay, whatever. 5 volts or 12 volts. That seems odd because it says 5 volts on the motherboard, and I don't remember it saying any other voltage on the board. So I think I'd probably just stick with that. USB output current 1000 milliamps. Really? Does that mean it can charge stuff? Not through those skinny power wires, I don't think. Output 2 by 3 watts into 4 ohm speakers. Again, I'd question that. I think I'd want to put an amplifier after it. But great music device for DIY projects. Yeah. If I had an amplifier to put in front of that speaker, that would be just awesome. Build that into a little boom box of some kind. Throw some batteries at it, maybe. FM bands. Auto search, auto storage. Yeah, I saw that. Custom antenna. Auxiliary input. MP3 playback. LED remote control. Different functions and whatnot. Yeah. That looks exactly like the one that I got. Cool. All right, next up. Description, spare part. Okay. Could be anything. Nothing else in there. Ooh, it's a breadboard. It's a transparent breadboard. I ordered an assortment of breadboards a long time ago. And we'll just have to see. I don't know. I remember watching, I always wanted additional breadboards. And I remember watching Julian Ilett video, and he got some that were kind of crappy. And that scared me off a little bit. But now that, so at the time, I ordered an assortment. Let's see what I got for components here. I can try in this thing. These guys all seem to want to go in fairly easily. Now, Julian had a couple that he'd gotten off eBay that were nice and cheap, but the holes were the kind of metal work where the hole where the component leads go in, instead of having a nice V like that it could drop right into, they were very blunt on top. But this one seems to be pretty reasonable. So that's neat. Oh, you can almost see on the end of the power strip rose, but you can see here that bends in and then bends back out again for the components to grab into. And then, can I hold this steady enough? And you actually plug the component in. Cool. That's a good one. Always use another breadboard around here. All right, the breadboard. I could not find another one from this seller. They're not selling them anymore by the looks of it. And this thing took so long to get here. I think it was bought and shipped in like May, I think, and I finally got it in August. But I did finally get it. Whole $1.97 Canadian. It's just your standard breadboard. All right, what's the next thing? It says nothing. This was the just the barcode the Canada Post puts on everything. No, that's my address in the back. I'm not going to show you that. Well, let's just take a peek and see what's in there. Oh, couple more breadboards. Okay. Those look exactly the same. It's the same package as the one that I just opened. And it's the same thing, but obviously from a different vendor. So, okay. Well, breadboards are useful. More the merrier. Two more of the mini breadboards. This time, got a bit more detail on it. 400 contacts from Satisfy Electronics. These two were $349 for the pair of them, and that was also free shipping. I can't imagine there's much to say about them down here. No. Just, yeah, how many points in that they're made of transparent plastic. Whoop-de-doo. Well, what's in this one? Electronic parts, electronic parts, electronic parts. Okay. Electronic parts. Okay, it says three different things. First of all, another breadboard. Only a full-size one this time. Same manufacturer, looks like. Okay, I don't have to spend any more time on that. I guess I'm not going to have a shortage of breadboards for a while. That's good. So what's in here? Oh, many, many things. Okay. So, 5, 10, 20 8-pin IC sockets and a couple of ICs, which are... Oh, come on. How come I can't read them? Okay, you may not be able to see that. Those are 80 tiny 85s. Okay. So that is basically the chip that's in the what is it called? Hang on. The Digispark. That's the non-surface mount version of the chip that's on this guy. Okay. So I can breadboard up now a Digispark. That's cool. And so what is this then? Let's zoom back out a little bit for a second. I think this is, it's a USB ASP version 2. So that's an in-system programmer. It's not the same as this, which is just a USB UART. This is a CH340. This one actually has, zoom back in, sorry for all the dizziness. Focus on that, thank you. That one actually has an Atmel 80 mega something or other. Trend 80 mega 8AAU. Okay. So this one, instead of going on to that set of pins there, oh wait, hang on. You didn't see what I was pointing at. Let me grab an Uno for a second. Okay, so this guy plugs into the ICSP programming pins on the end there. Yeah, this is in a nice little protective cheap case, which is glaring like horribly. You can't see a damn thing I'm doing. Let me just get that out of there. Okay. So that guy with its 8-pin connector goes. Oh, but that's a 6-pin connector. Oh, that's what these other things are for. Okay. This ICSP programming is all new to me. These CH340s or FTDIs, this particular one CH340, they connect to SCL SDA, or sorry, DTR, TX data and RX data, which on an Uno or pin 0 and 1, they do the same job as this CH340 here, or an FTDI, depending on what version you got. Doesn't matter. That needs the bootloader to program. This guy, with that little adapter there, plugs into the ICSP there, and it connects to MOSI, MISO, serial clock, reset, VCC, and ground. And I'm going to have to map out which ones those are. I can't remember if it goes that way or that way. And this guy can do either 3.3 or 5 volts to power it. So that allows you to program a bootloader onto the chip or program the chip directly, completely bypassing the USB and that. I didn't have an immediate use for it. I'm pretty confident that it was on sale for cheap, which is why I got it. So that's, okay, that's what that is. And then what are these guys? These three things are, they look like they're all the same, so I'm just going to open one of them. There's things, okay. Those are glaring horribly. This is, oh, okay. This is a little board that takes the ATtiny85 and turns it basically into a DigiSpark in a slightly different format. It comes with a 8-pin pin header, and that lines up as, well, you can read it, 5 volts, pin 0, ground, pin 3, pin 1, 2, 5, 4. Okay, and it's got 5 volts ground and V in there. And that V in goes through the little regulator there to make it into real 5 volts or power it from there. So that's pretty cool. And I, okay, so I got 3 of those. Oh, they're not all the same. So I got 2 of them with a socket on them. Okay. So I can plug those 2 into them. And the 3rd one is slightly different. It already has the ATtiny on it, the ATtiny 85 on it. So that may or may not have a bootloader on it, but it's going to be essentially a DigiSpark in a different form factor. That's pretty cool. Wow, that was a busy package. 2 pieces development programmer board for ATtiny 13, 28, 45, or 85. These are from Alice, just like that whole package full of stuff. Free shipping, $265 for a pair of them. What does it say about them down below here? Not much else, just that they're can plug the development board, whatever. Okay, 2 pieces of ATtiny-20PUIC from Ellis 101-1983, $2.80 for the pair of them Canadian, $2.21 if you happen to be an American. Then there's just a standard ATmega ATtiny85. 20 pieces 8-pin dip socket, IC socket, dual wipe contacts, just standard cheap sockets, $1.26 Canadian free shipping from our good friend Alice 110-1983. All right, yet another breadboard today. My lucky day, I ended up with a whole pile of them. This particular one came in the package with a bunch of other stuff from Alice. $3.23 Canadian. The USB ASP AVR programmer adapter with a 10-pin cable for ATmega 8 and ATmega 128. Okay, $2.08 free shipping from China from Alice 101-1983. And to go with the USB ASP, the 10-pin to 6-pin standard adapter board. Again from Alice, 2 of those for $1.26 or 99 cents American. More free shipping. And this here is this mini ATtiny 85 USB development board DigiSpark for DigiSpark Kickstarter. It's not really a DigiSpark, and for some reason, anytime eBay sellers mention DigiSpark, they have to say Kickstarter. Nobody knows why. It's just what they do. But this, like so much of what I got today, is also from Alice110 1983, free shipping, $1.66 from China. And what does it have to say about it down here? The Artmel AT Tiny. Ooh, I wonder who this Art guy is. I wonder if he knows what the Artmel company is. Wow, that is so butchered. I'm not going to get a lot of intelligence out of that. They spelled Atmel, or misspelled Atmel, three different ways in this one paragraph. Oh, that's awesome. Alrighty, and there is all the stuff from today's mailbag. That's great. There's a lot of winter projects in there. You can have fun with that. All right. Thanks for watching. Hope you enjoyed it. If you have anything, any questions or anything you want to say about it, tell me how awesome I am or how stupid I am down in the comments. You know what to do.